Hi, dear friend. If this were a magazine, this would be the global Dowland issue. And we're going to talk today about a little bit more serious issues than we normally talk about. We're going to talk about health, but on a little bit, a tiny bit larger scale than we are used to. We are going to talk about some global issues, which I usually call the seven P's, the seven rules of failure. In Taoism, there is a simple proposition about the experience of the human nature, that is, ourselves, of course. And that is the simple assumption that as the things are on the inside, so are the things on the outside. Taoist magic, Taoist rituals, Taoist practices, Taoist morality, everything is based on the idea that there is a kanying, a resonance between the interior and the exterior. When we are doing anything with conviction, it drives other people to believe that too. So that is why some people are charismatic and other people are not. This charismatic issue that people have is not necessarily a good thing. Adolf Hitler was charismatic, Donald Trump is charismatic. These are people who have the ability to fire up the base and to make them think things that maybe they shouldn't think. And as a result of that, they act in ways that maybe they shouldn't act like. It is very important as a principle, because when we practice medicine, we work with particular kind of ideas, theoretical concepts, you can say, like a yin yang theory, wu xing theory, pa kua theory, six qi theory, the different dampnesses, the different emotions, and so on and so forth. There's a lot of different kind of aspects of Chinese medicine physiology and physics, basically body physics, that are important. And we talk very often about environmental influences on our body, that when our body is not in order, then will affect our health, and as a result that we get sick. The thing is, though, that all these processes that we find on the inside, they are based on observations of what we find on the outside. That means we talk about our inner environment, our inner landscape, our inner cities, our inner society, our inner creatures, our inner spirits, and so on and so on, in the same way like we would talk about that on the outside world. Now, within our program, we have a special psychological development program. This is called Communications with Ghosts and the Spirits of Your Own Body. And this is to help you order the mental components and emotional components of your body in such a way that you structure yourself towards an ideal without addressing particular kind of complicated issues. And what I want to do with you now today is trying to solve problems without, in the outside world, without addressing the underlying stupidity or strange ideas or assumptions that are very often part of this. So let's make a start. Talk about the methods that we have available in Chinese culture, Chinese science. We very often talk about medicine on the inside, and medicine primarily is neidan. When we talk about the influence from the outside on the inside, we talk about the weidan. And in herbal medicine, and also in some immortality practices, that means swallowing things like a foo or herbs or foodstuffs to help the interior change. So we bring a direct influence from the outside. But things like sciences like feng shui, where we look at the environment, how to place things so that our ancestors can help us achieve success in this life or in the generations after us, or in ming shu, where we look at the stars, where we can see what society is going through in the coming time and how our personal character can play a role in that. This is elementary for these kind of things. In modern populist arts, of course, it is not exactly used like that. We just take vitamin pills and we look at our horoscope to see if today we're going to have a nice date, or we go put a cup in a particular way on a shelf to make sure that we earn a lot of money the coming years. You know, the kind of things that you would also do for a bingo game. What we have as a mediator between all these things is what we call the I Ching or the Zhouyi. And the I Ching is a set of 64 diagrams which have different layers of interpretation. And these different layers of interpretation, they can be extrapolated in such a way that we can see and understand and plan out strategies for dealing with the outside and the inside. And it takes a long time to study that. And we're not going to talk too much about these things now, because they are important when you want to understand something about Chinese culture. You can't do that without these things. I know that in modern time, in China also, these things are not that popular, because modern China is like the United States, is a new country, and they are, well, childlike country, and they do childlike things. And they are not totally aware of the historical context that is behind them, trying to educate them on how to do things. It's up to children, of course, to grow up as wise people, and they will eventually, hopefully with a little bit of guidance. When we talk about solving external problems in the world, we can basically say this is a form of health practice. And this health practice is something that we need to take serious. There are a lot of external issues in our modern life that need resolving, and if we don't resolve them, our children and our grandchildren, and if there are still going to be grandchildren after that, are going to live in a world which is a much an easier place than we are now living in. And we can say that we have to be active as medicine people. In a political way, in a social way, in an activist way, in social entrepreneurship, and all these kind of things, they are all part of healthcare when we do things, you know, focused. And of course, a lot of people, they have different kind of ideas, and these different ideas, they can be argued about, and they can be discussed for a long time until eventually people come to an agreement, and these agreements, they might or they might not work, and then they have to be discussed, and there has to be a blame game. There's all kinds of things that are there, but it is very easy to identify things and to start from the identification of problems, and I think we have to work with that. And you have to look at the world around you. You see that a lot of people, they try things, and it's very often in a sort of Disneyland kind of way, like Elon Musk, very famous with his ideas that, and a lot of people like him, to go to Mars and to spread out people to other places. Then they go from, well, a place that is still okay to a place which will become a prison because of all the limitations on life that are there. And it's never going to be a second Earth. And it's never going to be good enough to give us the options that we have right now. Then we are going to be pushed into a particular kind of canister, like a fish in a tin. And as a result of that, there's going to be things lost. And people don't realize that. But living in an artificial environment is always going at the expense of our natural qualities. People in artificial environments might experience themselves as being people, but in effect, they lose a lot of aspects of being human, and they become gradually weaker, and that will be the end of mankind. When we look at other people trying to come to solutions, they say like, well, you know, eventually everything's going to be solved because there's going to be a singularity, and the singularity is where technology, our technology, evolves in such a point that it merges with us, and then at that moment we can solve all kinds of things. So they're basically passively waiting, and as a result of that, in this passively waiting, they dehumanize us and they create something new. And I can say it is evolution, but it is not evolution. It is basically ignorance, because all the solutions are already in us. And if anything new evolution-wise has to happen, it has to be biological, because the nature that is not biological, the mechanical and the physical existence of nature, are just stones and rocks and liquids and, you know, all kind of stuff that isn't really alive and doesn't grow over millions of years. And the more technological we become, the less innovative we will become, the more static we will become, and eventually we just become like a rock. We are there, we don't expand, everything is managed and micromanaged and micromanaged, and as a result of that, it dies off. It is what you do when you put a tree into a pot. We are not trees that can be put into a pot. We are wild animals, just like all the animals around us in the larger society of all living creatures. And all living creatures together, they live together and they have their rights. The problem is that people think about people as being, you know, the only important thing. But in reality, we are nothing without the creatures around us. We live because of the creatures around us. And we can make, you know, artificial food by growing mushrooms and making it look like meat. Or we can grow bacteria in such a way that they can, you know, do all kinds of stuff. But it's not going to really solve anything. So we have to be really very practical on these kind of things. And as a result of that, come to a practical reality where we need to work together. And for this, the main solution is that we all unite in under one governance. And the world has to be put into one governance. How do you say that? Split into subdivisions. The idea of countries that are competing with each other is a little bit outdated. It's 19th century, and everything from the 19th century is basically bad and only brought us the First and Second World War. And you see this now repeating. Everybody's doing things that eventually will lead to a larger and larger conflict, escalating and escalating and escalating, isolating the world in separate areas of economic disaster. And as a result of that, people, the normal people, like you and me, we will carry the brunt of that. And some of the rich people on either side, they will feel great. And they think like, well, we do pretty okay. I mean, we have like so many billion people, we keep them alive, so everybody should be happy. The reality, of course, it is not about the fact that we are alive. It is about the fact that we are happy. When I was talking with my father the other day, I was talking with him about what he thinks about all the things that happens in the world. He's over 80 and he's fortunately is still doing okay and he's healthy. But he said like, well, as far as I'm concerned, my life is over. I don't have to worry about anything anymore because there's gruesome things coming to the world and they are even worse than anything that I went through from my childhood in the Second World War to now. There is a list, you can say, of things that are issues that we face in this time. And these are, of course, the current pandemic. You might or might not believe where if this pandemic is really real or if it's really a threat, but it is a symptom of the time that belongs to people living in cities. In nature, it's natural that there is a transmission from viruses from one species to another species. Because viruses, they mutate and adapt to new species just to make sure that they stay alive. That's why they were called ghosts and demons in the past, because they did do harm as a living entity does. So that solves the problem if a virus is alive or not. It's a ghost or it's a spirit or something. At the moment when it enters a body, it makes the body sick, it hijacks it and it makes it do things for its own survival and parasites on people. Some viruses are beneficial for us, so we get better with it, and some are not so very beneficial. And some, you know, a little bit more complex creatures also parasitize us, like bacteria and mitochondria, and they help us have a lot of energy and digest our food. And a lot of viruses inside us, they help us develop our metabolic processes, and actually, without them, probably we wouldn't be able to eat grasses. The problem then is cities. And we are now being pushed into a life where we wear masks and gloves, which you should. You're stupid if you don't, because that's the only way to protect each other like that. But we also have to start considering the idea that maybe we should try to live in another kind of way so that we are not clasped together. So that it's not easy for us to transfer things. Lao Tzu said in the Tao Te Ching, in the past people lived in small communities, and these small communities, even though they could hear each other in the distance, they would never, you know, really meet. And as a result of that, they wouldn't transport things between each other. They wouldn't have wars, they wouldn't have fights, they wouldn't have economic trade or anything like that. It is because we're doing all these kind of things that are the cause of a lot of these kind of problems. Especially in relationship to diseases. We transmit a lot to each other and we teach our children and so on how to live a lifestyle which basically make situation worse. So that as parents, we have to be educated at high school level, how to deal with disease and so on, in a way that we can teach our children when we get them, and that we take more personal responsibility for the well-being of our children. Yes, of course, that takes a lot of time, but you have to understand from the Daoland perspective, there's only one job that we have, that is living, and then living as long as we can, because that's our birthright. If we want to live in cities, we have to develop a different kind of lifestyle, we have to build a different kind of communities, and we have to put thoughts in how to do that. We cannot just spread all our houses, because then all the forests and all the mountains and all the swamps and everything else will have to disappear to make space for us. That is not a good solution too. We can make the whole world into a park, but it will definitely go at the expense of lions and buffaloes and elephants and mosquitoes. Oh, mosquitoes not so bad maybe, but maybe they are necessary. We as people, we have to solve it. Ants, they solved a lot of diseases for themselves and they live in big cities. So why wouldn't we be able to do it? We are supposed to be smarter than ants, aren't we? The second of the seven P's is population. We have a lot of people, and it actually comes back to the same problem as the previous one. The population is a huge problem because we are with so many people. And of course, we have started programs of birth control. We have to maybe go a little bit further than that. And I'm not in favor of social engineering or locking people out of their birthrights. You see what happened in China when everybody was having only one child. It engineered society, but it also created a lot of problems in relationship to the education of kids. You want to make sure that everybody who leaves then actually has a good life, because you can't offer people to leave for something even worse than what we are right now. Best, of course, would be to first of all solve it here, and then from there go look what else we can do. Then there is the pollution problem, and the pollution problem has many different kind of facets. It is not only air pollution, it's the sea pollution, it is the forest floor, the soil, through artificial fertilizing the floor, the sea and the floor, whatever kind of things. Our food, our meat, in case anybody would like to keep on eating meat and dares to eat meat, is continuously medicated with antibiotics so that everybody is in a continuous antibiotics course throughout his life, keeping the body temperature up, and as a result of that causing all kind of problems, making us susceptible to viral attacks. And as a result of the stress, we also tend to become a little bit more territorial and anxious about all kind of things. So it is easier for us to get into wars between populations. We see that we need a global governance for all the three things that we mentioned so far to solve these kind of things, because population can be carried better in one area than in another area, and when we do that we might be able to solve a lot of problems, and we can let people more freely mingle so that people notice that, you know, interracial things are not that scary. Anybody who is a racist is an ignorant fool, because the vigorousness of races is continuously renewed by mingling with other people. Races which are continuously only falling back on their own qualities, they eventually degenerate and they basically undermine their society. Just as intermingling also can undermine it if you don't do it in the right way, of course. You have to think about how to do things, and that is not what we usually do, because we leave all the problems to the individual regions. When we see the pollution in the sea, there's whole islands, continents, the size of France, just with plastic pollution. There's fishes living between them, and as a result of the pollution, you see that animals are stuffed with plastic in their gills and in their intestines, and when we catch them to eat them, we open up the fish and we, you know, we basically get our Starbucks cup back. When we go further than that, we see that prosperity is a big problem. We have a lot of prosperity in the sense that there is a lot of money going around and there's a lot of wealth going around, but at the moment most wealth is locked into a relatively small group of people, and then there is wealth large portion is locked into the wealth of particular countries. And that means that on the individual scale, people do not have much wealth. And even that is, compared to, say, 500 years ago, is huge. We are hugely wealthy in a large part of the world, but there are still large parts of the world where we are not. In Africa, there are still cities with no electricity, and there are still like a million people living there. And they have an economy and they have life, but everything is still done by hand, and they still have natural foods because they don't have fertilizer. And that has benefits, but we don't have that here. That means that these countries, they know a particular kind of wealth in another way than we know our wealth with lots of coins, whether they are bitcoins or whether they are dollars or whether they are yuan. In all essences, they are a dependency that creates a mental and emotional poverty, and that mental and emotional poverty is a handicap. Technically, it would be best to just get rid of money, just don't have money, just make sure that everything is distributed properly so that everybody has what they need, and if they need something more because of the nature of their character and their need for decadence or opulence or something like this, that they can have that. It is not something then that you have to be jealous of because somebody has more than you because they worked for it, or they get better paid, or they have stolen it, or anything like that. There is no need for these kind of things. So a lot of possession-related crimes, which is a concept which is created in the Roman Empire, we still live in that same kind of Roman thinking, is then immediately resolved, and as a result of that, a lot less people need to go to prison, which can help us to use the prisons as new apartment complexes to solve housing problems. Wouldn't it be something? Cells, of course, are not great, but you can connect a lot of cells with each other and you can make a nice penthouse with it. It's not a problem. It's just a matter of fantasy. Solving problems is just a matter of fantasy. There's materials enough, there's ability enough, and it's just a matter of planning and doing it. The next one that is very important is passivity. Like, I'm talking to you about this and I'm trying to do something in my own way, in how I can reach out to people. That's through this channel. And if you feel like, you know, what I'm doing is right, and then you immediately sign up if you haven't signed up yet. And you help me, tell me by saying like, oh, actually this is the reason why I became a member and I make more movies like this. But primarily we are healthcare developers, and healthcare developers goes in different kind of directions, and this is one of the directions that we need to go into. The passivity of people is tremendous. They say like, well, the government has to solve it. No, we have to go on the street and we have to go demonstrate, but we don't really do something when we demonstrate. It is really crazy, but if in your daily life you can't convince your neighbor not to be a racist, or you can't convince your children not to throw garbage in the garden, or to convince your partner to buy plastic packaged things in the supermarket, that you have to demand to your supermarket to have everything coming just like that, so that you can put it in your own pots and your own plastic bags, just like how it was in the 50s and the 60s still, and that gradually is wielded out in the favor of hygiene laws that usually also don't make too much sense anyway. Because more hygiene also means more vulnerability. So then we come back to pandemic. The more we live in a hygienic environment, the less resistance we build up against all kind of things. So that is not a good idea. And then as a last one, we have production. We produce a lot of stuff, but which of these stuffs we actually really need, right? We grow flowers. Flowers, very beautiful. I like them. I like flowers. I think flowers are beautiful. But they're better in a pot, so that they're better as a plant than as flowers like this. Because then we grow flowers like slaves, and we just cut them off and we put them in a vase to watch them how they die. It's morbid if you think about it. And death is beautiful. Then we have romantic poetry as a result of that. As a former goth, I think I can validate the idea of flowers. But in reality, if you think about it, it's not good. And we have a lot of things like that. Why do we have plastic cups? Why do we have paper cups? Why don't we have just our own cup with us and take that wherever we go, or wherever we want to drink, we put something in it and then we drink with it? Why is that not standard? That's why do we go to work and we expect our boss to provide all kinds of things? Why do we still make socks that after 1 week of wearing already has holes? Why do we need so many pairs of socks that you don't notice how quickly your socks are being falling apart? Why do we need to make lamps that take so much electricity that we have to run coal burning factories or nuclear factories to do that? Why can't we do that in a way which actually resolves things better? Because there are good quality solar panels that could be distributed freely, but they are, because of money, they are expensive to sell because people need to make their profits. But in reality, if we just dissolve the money problem, we can dissolve the solar panel problem, and we can dissolve the electricity problem and the pollution problem in the process of that. Because then we can also choose to make more healthy production processes. And then pricing. Pricing is the last one. Pricing is mainly the issue because everybody wants to earn a buck. And because everybody wants to earn a buck, they hope to become rich very quickly. And this is why I'm also preparing a new video about economy, because this is also an issue that I think we have to address. There's a lot of different kind of experiments on economy going on in the world all the time. And we only know about economy so far that all economies stink and they all have pitfalls and they all have problems. So the only real solution to economy, of course, is not having any money coming in your life at all. As a Taoist, I'm not supposed to accept any money. Of course, in this society, we need money. But how much money do we need? We only need money to rent a house. We don't need to buy a house. If we share the ownership of houses, the problem of housing is very quickly solved because nobody has a house which is more valuable than somebody else, or nobody has to earn more money than anybody else. We can just create all kind of houses and make people live in there as they please. Some people like to live in a small house. Some people like to live in a big house. So why wouldn't we be leaving it open to the urges of people that they have? I like a big house. I do. Yeah, because I like to have space to practice, and I like to do practices that I don't want to share with everybody just like that because people think I'm crazy. I like to do it in my own space so that I don't have to go to the park where maybe the police will arrest me when I do the practices that I do. That's the reality of things. We live in a society of ownership and shame. And only by working together we can resolve that. So the seven P's are in fact only one problem. That's namely the problem. So we have only one job, and that is staying alive as long as possible. And we have only one problem, that is not being healthy.
In the future, the problems that we have are going to be bigger than we have them right now. And I think we can solve this together. Of course, it will be easy to say if everybody becomes a Taolander, we can all agree about all kinds of things. That's not how it is. But what we can do is when we join each other, we can discuss these kind of things and we can create a package that is attractive to everybody to follow without people having to become a Taolander. I don't care if people become a Taolander or not, other than that I would like to get my ideas out, which are not actually my ideas, but the ideas of the people that I studied with, and which I think makes sense. As a whole, the idea that we need global solutions, I already started with this idea when I was in high school, when my religion teacher asked me, like, how would you solve world problems? And not only me, but everybody in the class, you had to write a paper, and everybody take only local issues. And I wrote a paper about how to redistribute cities and so on, so that there's more space for nature, and how to redistribute industry so that nature will be impacted less, how we could put the industry below the soil so that above ground there would be more space for nature as a whole, and that we would cluster industry in small spaces so that it doesn't pollute the landscape everywhere. There's a lot of solutions that are possible. People as a whole, they are extremely creative and they can come up with all kinds of things. They just have to be motivated to be working together. And in our body, there's a concept called the Jing, that's the coherence of our body. And that is something that we do. And in our mind, we have the same, it's called Chang. And this coherence is our mental coherence. In the world around us, we also need coherence. And this coherence we have to create together. And it is just by understanding what are our problems and how to coordinate in such a way that we can solve these problems in a practical way, no matter whether you're on the right or on the left or anything like that. You just have to realize, like, these are problems that are involving the whole world, and no individual country can solve that. You can send around emotive, stupid fake news, or you can repeat actual news. Nobody can trust any facts on any side in general anymore, because there's so much of it. But the reality is that there are particular kind of problems which are very easy to solve. And if everybody spends 2 hours a day working on cleaning up the environment, doing something that is actually helpful to the environment as a form of prayer for mankind and nature as a whole, that we spend time in resolving issues in our family life about packaging, about natural things and so on and so on, that we try to avoid buying stuff that is actually bad for the environment. If you don't need a car, and you have to be honest to yourself if you need a car or not, if you don't need a car, get rid of that stupid stinking thing. And if you got rid of this car and you do still need a car, make sure you are part of a community that shares cars. It's so simple.
Well, I hope you liked this video. It is much more political than I normally do, and it is trying to avoid concrete details about all the issues that we are facing in our daily life, because I don't think it's my place to try to be technical about all these kind of things. But as a motivator, I can point out in several kind of directions that I think, like, this is where we have problems. And fortunately for me, all the problems that are facing our lives at this moment, they are part of only one letter, namely the P. And that makes it easy to summarize them and to give them a nice catchy name, the 7 P's. And that is how it's supposed to be. We are supposed to be busy all day with working on improving the quality of our lives. We're not supposed to entertain ourselves and feel confident that we can drink beer on a terrace, because drinking beer in general is not a very good and healthy thing. And there's nothing you can say about doing things that are habitually offending the health of our body.